A dream is creation too. What you dream about is a reflection of what your habit of vibration is about. Just like what you think and feel is what translates into your wake experience, what you think and feel translates in your dream experience too, because you're the creator of your dream, just like you're the creator of everything in your life experience. So when you awaken from a dream that feels really good, then it's good to stop and think about it. When you awaken from a dream that doesn't feel good, we know the tendency is to try to get it away and try to figure out what went wrong. And sometimes it's not easy just to turn over and go back to sleep. We will always tell you how it is, and we will never flatter you. We will never twist the laws of the universe in order to suit what you were doing. We will always tell you the laws of the universe as they are, just like law of attraction will always follow the identical vibration that you're offering to replicate it in many ways. It never gets squirrely on you. We'll never deceive you. And so you translated that in Abraham's going to tell you what they know, whether you want to hear it or not, whether you're ready to hear it or not. Abraham's going to give you the laws of the universe. We've been talking to you about how your inner being is all about who you are and what you want, and how every negative emotion that you have ever is because you're thinking in opposition to that. So if that is true, and it is, how could it be possible that when you are in vibrational sync with your inner being, that inner being would say something to you that you don't want to hear? That's not even possible. And if you think that that's what's happening, you're under some other influence, or you're translating it through your distorted lens of unworthiness, or your distorted lens of not enoughness, something like that is going on. If your inner being is saying something to you like, there is so much that you're asking for and so much that we're wanting to offer in response to that, but sometimes you're not letting it in, so you don't hear it. In the early days when Jerry and Esther were getting to know us, we encouraged them to utilize us in any way they could, because we wanted them to know how much we knew about them and how much we knew about where they were specifically in the world. So they cooked up this scheme. It was really our idea. Esther translated it, and some friends who they knew who were aware of us, really the only people at that time who were aware of us, because Esther was keeping it a secret, because after all, it's weird. And so Esther said, all right, you guys, they were living in Phoenix. Phoenix is 50 miles wide and 50 miles long. It goes far, 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 far in every direction. And Esther said to them, you guys go hide somewhere and we'll get Abraham to help us find you. They said, where? Esther said, doesn't matter. They said, really? Esther said, you can go to Tempe, you can go to Mesa, you can go to Albuquerque, you can go anywhere in this metropolitan area and Abraham will find you. And so off they went. They said, we'll give you a half hour head start. So off they went, and then off Jerry and Esther go. Now Esther's not speaking like this. She was receiving on the typewriter, but in those days she didn't have the typewriter. Her impulse was saying, let's go that way. Jerry was driving, let's go that way, let's go that way, let's go that way. So they come to the first place and we said, stop here. So they stopped and their friends weren't there. It was behind the dumpster at the Mountain Shadows Hotel, and they weren't there. So off they went again. They ended up over on Scottsdale Boulevard at Benihana's, and they're sitting in the parking lot, they're looking all around, and then off they went again. They stopped seven or eight places and did not find them, and finally they found them. They ate three Snicker bars and filled the car up with gas twice. That's how long this went on. It went on and on and on and on and on. Esther said, we're not going to play this game ever again, because it was a long game. She thought it would be much quicker. And then she said to her friends, we were at the dumpster at the Mountain Shadows, but you weren't there. And they said, we were, but Abraham told us to move. And Esther said, we were behind Benihana's on the very back side. They said, we were there, but Abraham told us to move. Now, what we're getting at here, things are always moving, they're always evolving. In other words, we wanted Esther to understand that not only was she getting insight, but other players in her co-creation were getting insight too. And when she thought about it, she doesn't know anybody more fun than those two. She doesn't know anybody that's played more jokes than those two. Their inner beings were resonating completely with their intention to give Jerry and Esther a really good time. And boy, we all did. And Esther's inner being was helping her to find them. And eventually they did. So what we're saying to you is, you get what you expect and the universe will cooperate with you. You get what you're thinking about. And when you start hooking up with source energy, oh, then what you get is more expansive and more rewarding and ultimately, moment by moment, more satisfying. Sometimes you're on your way to something. Sometimes your inner being will lead you to an experience that will help you to activate and fine-tune vibrational frequencies within you, so that the next rewarding thing is available to you, and the next, and the next, and the next. And that's why we were saying Jerry and Esther looked there, and then they looked there, and then they looked there, and then they looked there. They looked a lot of places before they found them, and all those places that they went were right also. And that was the fun of the game that we were all playing together, is that they were there. They weren't there when Jerry and Esther got there, but they had been there. And the fact that they had been there, and they had told them they had been there, so Jerry and Esther knew that they were on the trail. It just took them a while to catch up. Let's talk about timing. And the way we mean timing is when you come into conscious awareness of something. We want to put with the word timing words like co-creation, words like blending, words like synchronicity, and many factors coming together simultaneously. When you have big intentions where there are many things that your life has helped you to know that you want, then the best of timing includes a high percentage of those. In other words, when you say, I'm on a timeline to get a job, we want to say, are you on a timeline to not only find employment, but to find rewarding employment? Not only to find something to do, but something that interests you and excites you while you do it. Not only others to work with, but others who are in harmony, who are also reaching for more. In other words, there's a lot more to what you're asking for than just what you want to define with time. So if something isn't happening, it's because you're asking for more than you're letting in. And that is, hear this, that's an indicator of a really strong and powerful deliberate creator. Because if you are sloppy in your creation, then your timing can be quick. In other words, you can be brought immediately to something that you think you want, and then you have to go through the experience of finding out that that really isn't what you want, or that there's more about it that you don't want than that you do want. But perfect timing is really, from our perspective and the way that we want to say it, is really good timing is when you allow a large number of components that are important to you to rendezvous simultaneously. And nothing less than that will do. You don't want to just put up with a little piece of something you want, like it happened in the timeline, it happened before my deadline was in place. We want you to be willing to allow the universe to round up all of the cooperative components that you're asking for, which include a lot of factors. And we want to say to you that you're the last of the cooperative components. You're not letting yourself in because you're so aware of what is. That's what deadlines and goals do in a detrimental way to you. They make you focus upon the absence of what you want. They make you nervous. They make you feel frustrated. They make you feel tense. You don't want to introduce into your equation of intent those things that make you feel like that. You want to step back and say, when I'm ready, it'll be there. When it's ready for me and I'm ready for it, then it will be there. And when it comes, I will know it. I won't question it. I won't wonder about it. It will feel good to me, even though I don't really understand how it's going to unfold. And in the beginning, it will be far less that it will be later, and it'll be far less that it'll be later. And this is something that's going to expand and evolve as I do too. But what happens so often with humans is you want to fast forward there, and you want all the answers that might answer any questions that you might ever have to be satisfied before you even have the questions. And what you're really wanting to do is just have an expansive, good feeling experience. And from what we've been talking about here today, what do you think is the way to get there in the fastest and the most easy way? Is to feel good about where I am. Well, that takes some doing, because right now I don't have something that I really want, need. That doesn't matter. You can find the emotion of it. Well, I don't know if I can find the emotion of it until I have some glimpses of it. Yes, you can. When you don't have enough money, you can put prosperity and a feeling of well-being in there. If on past jobs you haven't been respected, you can put the respect that you want and deserve, and that you want to give and that you want to receive. In other words, you can find those. So as you isolate some of those things that you're looking for, and then you go out in the day and the universe delivers something to you, like the rabbits or whatever it is, that fills in that little piece and that little piece, before you know it, you're resonating with so many of the things that are important to you that you're now ready to allow yourself to be the receiver of what's been being revealed for a long time. You think the universe isn't showing it to you. It is. The revelations are happening all around you. But you've got to be in the receptive mode before you can realize what's being revealed. As you look at it that way, then you don't feel deprived. It's in the gestation process. It's not coming, it's coming. Don't you want the timing of the birthing of the baby to be right? Don't you want it to have fingers and toes before it gets here? Oh, I was in a hurry for you, sorry about that. My desire was so strong that you got here that you got some catching up to do, I see. And so you get the point.